Well, good morning, everybody. This is Deborah Watson. I am the curator for the Branson International Film Festival, and we just want to welcome you to our third annual festival that has gone virtual and hopefully viral too. Who knows what is planned for this year? All I know is we're doing an early kickoff today with Jamie and Shalom, who are attached to an organization called Japan Hope. And I'm not going to take up any more of their time, but I would be happy to introduce you to Jamie, who looks like in the picture on Facebook, he's below me, and Shalom, who is next door to me. And Jamie, I would like for you guys to just introduce yourselves and tell us about the work that you're doing there in Japan.
Sure. My name's Jamie, and I came to Kyoto about 3 years ago. I came to Japan originally as a missionary with a filmmaking background, and we started doing this film series over the last maybe year and a half, 2 years, and it's just been an incredible experience, totally in faith, and just really stepping out to do something just that God had put in my heart.
You've only been doing this for 2 years?
But this particular project, yeah. I started making films when I was a kid, went to film school, and coming to Japan with a filmmaking background, I'd always hoped maybe one day to make narrative short films in Japan. And the Love Project film series, which is part of what Branson had selected, was a way for us in Japan to create short films while sharing God's love through storytelling, through narrative short films. And this project is also like a film workshop where everybody involved gets to learn about the filmmaking process, whether they have experience or not.
That's awesome. And Shalom, how did you get involved with Jamie in this?
Well, we met at a film workshop up near the capital in Tokyo, and we kind of hit it off, and he was like, hey, do you want to produce this kind of story project that I have? And I said, sure, why not? So it's been definitely a learning experience for me as well. I don't have much filmmaking background, but definitely love learning on the job and learning new things. So this has just been an amazing experience for me as well.
Yeah, so I bet now you can say, I know a lot about filmmaking that I never knew I was going to know.
Exactly.
So Shalom, where are you originally from, Shalom?
I was born and raised here in Japan. I mix Japanese. My father is from England. All my life here in Japan, both, you know, growing up speaking both languages. So definitely have a heart for Japan.
That's awesome. Okay, so speaking of heart, Jamie, why this topic and why is this message important, not just for Japan, but for the nations?
Well, I think love is a very subjective topic, right? There are a lot of movies that involve love, and in the film industry specifically, we know that love can be from rated G to rated R and all different forms of content. And I thought that this was an opportunity to really specifically identify how love can be defined. And the Bible in 1 Corinthians 13 has very specific definitions of love. It says love is such and such, like love is patient, love is kind, love is not envious, love is not self-seeking. They're really specific things. They're really specific definitions. And I think as human beings, we can have conversations about what love is or is not. But I thought as a filmmaker and as a filmmaking team, it would be really interesting to explore what if we were to make films based on those themes so that we're not saying what we think love is, but we're making a statement about what the Bible says that love is. And the challenge was, how do we do that in a way that's not preachy? And how do we do that in a way that's not really obvious? Because these are geared towards a secular audience. All of these films are aimed at a secular audience. So yeah, this was just an opportunity. Sorry. This was an opportunity to explore biblical themes with a standard narrative short film.
That's awesome. Now, one of the things that we did with this year's film festival, because it really is unprecedented, there's rules and regulations within the film festival circuit that if you have more than 50 people view it, it could be considered a public viewing. And so at your request, people are not able to watch it because we weren't sure. So if they did want to partner up with you, have access to be able to watch them and possibly even help support you in your mission work there in Japan, where can they go?
Well, thank you for asking about that. Because of different things right now, and because it is a lot of things online are, yes, it can go in different ways. We have decided to only screen our films in physical places at the moment, but we definitely want to, in the future, see where this will go. But we do have social media pages on both Facebook and Instagram, where we post updates about and behind the scene footage and festival updates and even teaser videos from the episodes. We also have a website where you can get some more information. It is whatislove.jp. That's just one word, whatislove.jp. And you have some information on there, as well as a PayPal link for those who want to partner with our ministry or support us on this journey. We're actually in the process and in production mode for the next four films of ours. So we definitely have a lot more work ahead of us. But we're so grateful for all the encouragement and support that Branson Film Festival has given us.
Yeah, and we'll make sure to put the links in the comments below as well. So that way people know how to find you. And I'm not going to give away too much, but I think it would be really fun if we all of a sudden saw a lot of red umbrellas pop up around the
That would be amazing.
That was probably one of my favorites. In fact, that would be a bad fundraiser idea, if you don't mind, if we end up partnering up with you guys, if we make red umbrellas available and have the profits come to your projects you're working on.
That would be awesome.
Definitely in rainy season right now.
That was actually the first film that we did. That was about 2 years ago, and it was completely in faith. And I don't want to give anything away, but there is a critical scene that happens that we planned that film 3 weeks in advance, and it was the only day we could shoot it. So what you saw happen on camera was truly an act of God for that specific moment.
Wow, that's awesome.
Yeah.
I love hearing those kind of testimonies. So you guys are really going to want to get in and see these films and partner up with Shalom and Jamie and the team. So speaking of the team, because I have had to work with skeleton crews, and I'm getting ready to work with what COVID is allowing us to consider a full set crew and where in between. How many people did it take for your crew to create these?
Well, each filming day specifically varied according to people's availability, as it is all, we are all volunteering to get this done. There were sometimes just Jamie and me behind the camera, or there was maybe one crew or two. It was maybe four on a good day, was really good. But yes, it's definitely been different depending on the episode or the film or even the day of our filming.
That's awesome. And it shows that you can do a lot with a little, and sometimes you can do a little with a lot. We have a lot. Most studios have backlots and all of these great equipment and stuff all around you. And it sounds like you guys are creating great content with the simplicity of what you have available. What's kind of on your dream bucket list as to where you see things in 5 years?
Ooh. That's a good question. Hopefully in 5 years, we'll be done with the last film. We're pretty close to done with the last four films. And I think beyond that, we just want to do post and start submitting those last four to new film festivals just to get the exposure. But I think we're really trusting God with what the next steps look like for this project, but even just for ourselves. I know for me, in my filmmaking career, I mean, I came as a missionary, but I still want to make films. I know Shalom has just as many ambitions as I do, if not more. So I know that for myself, just taking things a day at a time, trying to be faithful with this kind of miraculous opportunity that God has with us right now, just to be faithful with that, to finish it. And really, I'm trusting God with what happens next.
I heard somebody share with me this last week that was really spot on. And you just basically said the same thing, is that we live with a lamp before our feet, not a spotlight in our eyes. And you walk that way and live that way. It's just such a peace in the midst of a very chaotic career and industry, that there's a beauty that inhabits that. Shalom, what would you say your strength is? Is it storytelling? Is it technical? Is it, do you have the creative eye for laying out the next scene? What have you discovered about yourself to be your strength?
I think more the administrative side and keeping things aligned on set, on schedule as much as possible, making sure everyone knows where they're supposed to be, what they're supposed to be doing, also translating between the people who don't speak English or Japanese. Yes, a lot of kind of making sure everything goes as planned. role that I carry. But yeah, I really enjoy that. I think there are moments where it's very intense, and I definitely learn a lot. But yeah, it's enjoyable to see how God kind of uses even the small things, and things that I, in the past, that I didn't think would be important, that I learned, but have been able to learn, use on set, because I learned that specific skill, or I learned that specific piece of knowledge.
So Jamie, you're doing each one of the love is patient, love is kind. Are you going to go through and do every single word so that you end up creating a season or an episodic piece that people can purchase the big package when it's all complete?
That's a good question. I think when we started out, the original plan was to do every theme. But I noticed that as I was starting to write, like as a writer, you'll probably appreciate this. And for any of the writers who are listening, they say not to write for theme, to write for story, and then to discover the theme, right? So for the first four films, first four or five, actually, that we did sort of lock as a beat breakdown and pitched to Shalom before we started, I did not look at the love themes at all. I just said, let's just try to make the best four or five stories possible and then figure out how they fit. And by the way, when we started this, we did sort of crowdsource all different kinds of story concepts and stuff from all of our team volunteers and showed up. So this is a very sort of mixed voice that we developed the stories from. So once the four or five stories were picked, it was really just a matter of saying, okay, what love themes do these best fit? And then it was easier to match it up that way. The challenge came to how do we move on from these four? Because we wanted to do more, but it's like, how many more do we do? It's hard. It's been really hard for all of us. It's been fun and rewarding, but there are times where Shalom and I, and probably the team too, are just like, how many more of these can we do? After shooting story number five, I think on day one or two of story number five, it was like, how many more do we even have in us? Because it's really hard work. When we were developing four, five, six, seven, and eight, we had to look at the themes that were left. And it actually started to be kind of clear that some of the themes are very similar. If you look at the love themes, they're very sort of overlapping. And some of the themes just aren't as, I would say, compelling as a sort of drama narrative. They were maybe very soft, very like not as hard hitting. So it was, I kind of had to choose, do I just start writing the scripts, or do I pick the theme and write for the theme? And I felt that because of the remaining themes, it would be smarter to write for theme. So we kind of flipped the process a little bit that way. And I feel like it helped us out a lot. Because I told Shalom, if the story was written and it didn't match with any of the themes, we'd be in really big trouble. Because that's like the whole point.
Yeah.
So we picked four, and we developed four, and we've shot about two, three and a half. We have one left, and the others just haven't been edited or anything. After we get eight in the can, I think we'll be done. We kind of agreed that eight would be good. And I think I feel good about that. Shalom feels good about that. And we'll see what happens from there. But beyond that, really just trusting God.
That's a beautiful number too, because 8 stands for new beginnings, because there's 7 days in a week and the 8th day is the start of something new. So you're probably right.
Oh, good.
So one of us, and I'm kind of old school because you guys definitely look much younger than me. There's a song by Sandy Patty called Love in Any Language. And that's one of the things that, without giving it away, you guys did a very unique way of delivering a love message without saying a whole lot, which was really well done. And that's one of the reasons why we gave you the honorable mention, because it's something that is unique and different, and yet speaks volumes to those that are watching, that have eyes to see and ears to hear in a very unique way, because it does, like, the message is so there, even over just a simple cup of coffee, you know? And so I know for me as a filmmaker, I really appreciated the art that you have. And Barbara Nicolosi, who's our professor from Regent University, and we'll be playing her video tomorrow on a class that she's offering on May 17th. That's one of the things that she says modern day films in general are lacking, is that people have forgotten the art of filmmaking and just dive into just getting their story told. And they miss the whole point of the beauty of using media as an art form as well, because it really truly is. So thank you for doing that, because I know if and when she watches your guys' work, she's going to fall in love with it because of what you've done. So good job.
Thanks.
So Shalom, you keep everything together. You're a great line producer, it sounds like, an administrative genius, more than likely, because you guys are still moving forward.
Yeah.
What, Jamie, with if she was a fly on the wall, how important and valuable is it to have a good administrative team to stand by your side to get it done, so that you can focus on the art form, allowing them to be cohesive with you as you're working, but let her do her job and do it well?
Absolutely. It's completely essential. In film school, they force you to collaborate. So whether you go in as a hotshot filmmaker who thinks they can do everything, or you're completely novice, you are forced to work in a collaborative capacity with everybody in their designated roles. So you have to learn how to work with everybody from production design to cinematography to producing. And I learned very quickly in film school how having a great producer will make or break you. And when we started this project, I wasn't originally thinking of Shalom as a producer. Actually, I thought, oh, she's interested in film. We did this 48-hour film challenge workshop together, and she seems really interested, and she seems really connected to Japan. She was born. And there were so many things that just made sense about it. But as we started working together, just these flags started going off of her, like, having this kind of these producer instincts. Mm-hmm. And it was just so obvious that, because we hadn't really figured out how we were going to define the roles anyway. And I'm just thinking, man, she's like a natural producer. Like, she needs to just be the producer of this thing. And she has done an amazing job, because all of her instincts are really good. Like, when we make a plan, we need to contact people, set those meetings up, get the times, where are we going to do it? I need to send that information out. All that stuff is so important for the creatives. And Shalom's a creative as well, but her instincts in the administrative, they do free me up to focus on the storyboards, the beats, the script, the camera planning, all the production design. It really helps me keep my head in the story when we're able to ping pong. And I know that in the background, she's able to talk to people about what's happening, where they need to be, what time things need to happen. When we're on set, I mean, I actually created a meme, and I hope that she doesn't show it to you. I created a meme where she's like locking the schedule. I'm like, let's go again. And she says, we need to move on. But I think that's the beauty of collaboration, is, you know, when the director wants to go again and the producer says we need to move on, and that's how you move on. Yeah, it's incredible, but it's absolutely essential. And I thank God that we met, because I know that I couldn't do this without not only our team, but I definitely couldn't do it without her.
Yeah, so she's a drill sergeant is what you're saying.
Yes, but sometimes she does walk up to you with snacks and put it in your face. She has fed me numerous times. I'll feel a tap on the shoulder and I'll turn and a cracker will fall into my mouth.
That's awesome.
It is.
Yeah, it's funny because the project we're going into, I actually met our first AD at a film festival in Orlando and over a Twix candy bar. my cell phone was dying and I asked if I could plug it in behind them. They could babysit it while I went to lunch. He said, yeah, but it'll cost you. I was like, what? And he's like, a Twix candy bar. I was like, that's easy enough. But now that I've asked him to be our first AD, he's like, oh man, I'm going to have to be the bad guy, aren't I? And I was like, yes. And I think you'll do it very well. He does have a certain finesse, a grace, but also, we got to get the job done and we can worry about everybody's feelings and emotions after the fact because we have a task in front of us. And that's when you know you have a great team, when you can go through the fire on set and come out on the other side and not even smelling like smoke. So.
Absolutely.
Jamie, if there is one thing that you could let all nations understand about the culture of Japan, and maybe some misunderstood or lack of knowledge of the people and the culture and the beauty that's there, as well as the diversity that's there, what would be that one thing you would want the nations to know about the lifestyle and the life in Japan?
Gosh, you're asking me that question, not Shalom.
Well, Shalom's been there all her life. So there.
I think that's a tough question. But I think that what I would say to the nations, as somebody who's always had this love and draw to Japan, I think is to acknowledge that Japan, and probably like most people, most races and most nations, but like Japan, that there's complexity and there's a lot to that we should never take at face value, whether that's growing up in Japan and thinking that Japan does things a certain way, or being outside of Japan and saying Japan is beautiful and everybody's very polite and everything's very clean, and all of those things have truth. All of the extremes have truth. But I think with Japan, there is a lot of complexity that's very difficult to identify. And I think in a lot of ways, it's one of the beautiful things about Japan. But it's also one of the things that it's very difficult to define, and it's worth looking at. It's worth thinking about. And I think that my perspective has completely changed about what Japan is, what Japanese people are like, what the beauty of Japan is compared to maybe the not so beautiful parts of Japan, the not so beautiful sides of people's personality or corporate culture or any number of things. But every nation has those things. Every nation can be glamorized or thrown under the bus for different aspects of personality and culture. So I would say Japan is complex as a nation, but as you get closer to it and really think and get to engage the personalities and the people and the complexities of those the culture, I think it's very beautiful and very insightful, very eye-opening. And I think that not only just looking at Japan and just being willing to say, I don't know everything, is one thing. And I think it really applies to every culture.
And Shalom, I'm going to give it back to you. How has it been working with somebody who was not born and raised in your culture and having that different point of view coming into your culture or your ecosystem, so to say, in a very diverse group of people? Has it been like an asset? Has it been kind of challenging? Like, what is like that ebb and flow like? To try and blend together and work cohesively together?
Well, I think we definitely balance each other out in many ways, which I'm really, really grateful for. And really, more than a business partner, so to speak, just a really great friend that I've gained over the last 2 years of working with Jamie. And I think there are definitely moments where it's like, we think differently because of the way we were raised, or just the culture that we were raised in. And it's kind of fascinating to see that difference and just how the someone's worldview can be so different because of where you grew up. So that's been also very good for me to see, you know. And I grew up in a very international circles as well. I mean, I'm mixed, and we have lots of mixed friends as well. And so just seeing the diversity in that, and our team, we have over 13 different nations, I think, from people who have come and gone and worked and partnered with us, that we have had a lot of different people from different nations and different tongues. And it's just been so beautiful to see that even though there are many differences, and sometimes we have a hard time communicating and there may be miscommunication, that we can create something together for one purpose, and that's to share God's love. And I think for Jamie and I, there are times when there has been miscommunication, even though we speak the same language. But at the end of the day, both our hearts is that we want to share God's love, and anything outside of that is not that important. So, yeah.
You know, you brought up a really interesting point, Shalom. We get the opportunity to interview the creator of the film, Heart of Africa. He's actually from the Congo. And when he went to film school, they pretty much told him that to create a film industry in their country, he was wasting his time. And yet he has created a very good piece of art. And he's stuck here in the United States right now because of the quarantine that we're under, which has been a huge blessing to be able to interview him. And one of the things we had talked about is, what would it be like if Christians from around the world could actually come together someplace and work together and create something? And when you were talking, I thought, you know, where would this summit be, where obviously if you brought that many people together on a collaborative work, you would need more than a 48-hour film festival or a 48-hour project. But from your perspective, Shalom, if you could pick like the ideal country to do a collaborative work with people from around the world, where would that place be?
Well, I may be biased, but I think in some ways Japan has a very, I don't know if that makes sense, but a kind of a calm base where people can just kind of come together. And I really feel that there is a draw to Japan as well. And so, you know, like I said, over 13 different nations, there have been people who are in Japan who are interested in collaborating with different people. So my first choice would probably be Japan. But I think, I've been to England, and I feel that there is also, I've been to different places that have quite a big international presence there. And there's also definitely a space for like, let's come together and let's just do something for God and let's, yeah, collaborate together. So probably those would be my two options off the top of my head.
That was really good, because it was a random question a little bit. So would it be in the city where there's all these different places that you could film at, or would it be more the countryside where you have more calm, serene imagery around you?
In Japan, you mean?
Sure.
You know. I think I grew up more in the nature. I live on a mountain. So I would choose the nature, I think. There's just a lot more openness and calmness. The city can get quite intense sometimes. So, I mean, most of our filming days and locations are in the heart of the city. So definitely experience that. But I definitely like to try, you know, filming in the mountains and in the nature and just kind of showcasing God's beauty that way as well.
Awesome. Well, to kind of wrap it up, because I know you guys are on a time crunch today, and thank you so much for doing this live. One more time, I'll put the contact information below, but what would be that final message, Jamie, that you would want to leave people with so that they can be thinking about it through the festival as other filmmakers, as well as the audience that's watching without being able to watch your work right now through the festival. What would be that one little nugget that you would like to leave with them that when they leave the festival and leave the event, they're going to say, you know, I remember Shalom and Jamie from Japan Hope, and this is why.
I think if I can give you two things, two things come to mind that relate to our project. I would say, first of all, to filmmakers, I remember feeling this in film school, and I feel even more strongly about it now. I firmly believe that you can have all the talent in the world for yourself or the most talented crew and team. I still believe very strongly it takes an act of God to make a good film, a great film. I think people can make a good film, but I think to make a truly great film that touches people's hearts requires an act of God and requires God to move on that project and be a part of that project. And I think that God has done that on this. And I'm just amazed that we've gotten this far. And I just encourage every filmmaker out there, anybody who is even thinking about God and feeling like they're separate entities, filmmaking as a secular industry, God as this sort of religious, spiritual thing, I think that they are both wonderful and work very, very well together. And I believe that you can make a great film, but when you involve God, it takes it places that you just could never imagine. And you saw that in the first film. For yourself. And that's when I know and Shalom knows that we could not have done this on our own. And we experienced that on this last film, right, Shalom? So I would say, I just encourage everybody, you know, whether it's filmmaking or something that you're passionate about, to really think about what it means to involve God and let God surprise you with where he takes you and where he takes your passion. The other thing that I would say is there's a scripture that says something like, if the farmer waits for perfect weather, they'll never plant, something like that. I can't remember exactly where it is, but like, if the farmer waits for perfect weather, they'll never plant, they'll never harvest. And I think that God, in every aspect of our lives, calls us to step out in faith. And I'm not the most courageous person, but this really was an opportunity to take a faith step. I mean, almost everything, the carpet had been pulled out from under me. This was an opportunity to try something new. When I met with Shalom, we stepped out in faith for this project, and God has taken us so far. And as you saw from that first film, and I can't spoil it, but we stepped out in faith for a specific weather scenario that we could not have planned 3 weeks in advance. And that was just basically like a type and shadow of God meeting us by taking a step of faith. And it's really all walking by faith and not by sight. That's been like the key verse of this whole film series: walk by faith, not by sight. So I would encourage every filmmaker, every creative, every believer, whatever it is that you're passionate about, like, don't wait for perfect weather to take that faith step. Be wise, get a team, get counsel, get people to come behind you, but take a step of faith, not by sight, and see where God meets you. So I think that God elevates our work when we commit it to him and involve him to places we could never imagine, and he meets us when we take faith steps.
Shalom, do you have anything you would like to add?
I totally agree with what Jamie has said. That's, I think, been our theme for the whole project. Just time and time again, God, we're like, God, I don't know if this is going to work. We don't know if this is going to happen. But he's, you know, he just said, just step out and it will happen. And time again, God has just completely come through and blown us out of the water, better than what we had expected. So really trust God, and if God is a part of it, then there's nothing else you can do. You know, God will come through, and yeah, the greatest gift.
Amen. Well, again, Jamie, Shalom from Japan Hope, thank you so much for your time today and for helping us kick off the third annual film festival. And who knows, maybe one day we'll be able to see you face to face or do some more interviewing and partnering with you between now and then. So please stay in touch and continually pushing forward into all that he has planned for you. God bless you, okay?
Thanks. God bless you.
Okay, bye.
Bye.
Okay, cut. Thank you cool. guys so much for your time. And if it's okay with you, I really love that red umbrella idea.
Yeah.
So why not have people in different nations partner up with you? So if you don't mind, at some point in time, I may edit this recording down and send it out to people and see who would be interested in partnering up with that project and see what happens.
Yeah.
Wow. Thank you so much.
Yeah, I've learned a lot about merchandising along with the films that can help bring income streams, even if it's just a little trickle. You and I both know you can make $10 go a long way in the right hands.
Yeah.
So, all right, awesome. Well, if there's anything we can do to help you guys out, Jamie, please, or Shalom, either one of you, just shoot us an email and let's just stay in touch, okay?
Thank you. I just
thank you so much
for your encouragement and even setting up this interview ahead of time and your early morning. Thank you so much for all
of it. It's my honor. It really is. I appreciate serving you guys because when one of us rises, we all rise together. And there's such a strong network that the Lord is pulling together to invoke change in the industry. And my passions is I actually, because we used to be missionaries as well, but we used stage productions. And I learned that the very first moving picture was created to by a priest in Europe to go to Africa to share the gospel. And I thought they called them magic lanterns. And I thought, you know what? It's time to redeem back that thing that was created for the honor and glory of God and just keep it moving forward and allowing it to grow and invoke change in the industry. So thank you for being part of that change.
Definitely.
All right.
Is there anything we can pray for the festival since it's a couple days, right?
No, it started today.
Yeah.
And it's running for a couple of days. The biggest thing we're running into is there's a couple of the DVDs that just are not uploading because there's just so much data.
Yeah.
And it's just a matter of there's a couple of them we're going to be moving around. So that way it'll stream better and not have so many glitches. So I think the biggest thing with the festival, like when we established it, so many of the festivals are all about bringing these huge gatherings together and charging ticket prices and making money. And we want to be more about getting that quality of filmmakers together to have moments like we just had a collaborative work. So I'd rather have a smaller festival with quality education, quality connections happening. And I have learned in these 3 years that my ideas usually get superseded by his ideas. And at the end of it, it's just, Lord, you were just, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
So just pray that everything he wants to achieve is done and that we get out of the way. Technology gets out of the way. And, I mean, COVID itself, we wanted to do virtual last year and our Wi-Fi was not a good connection at all. And quarantine ended up forcing us into a position where we're not collectively together in one spot, but we are virtually. So we achieved what we wanted to achieve last year when he was preparing us for what was yet to come. So
that is incredible. That is truly incredible.
Yes. And I have two Shalom live on a mountaintop, even though it's a little tiny mountain. So I understand completely where you're coming from. So who knows? Let's stay in touch and see if there's a work in progress in the near future in Japan, or I'm not sure where. I know we're working with somebody in Italy right now. So I'm kind of exploring how that all works together. So
great.
All right. Well, we are 5 minutes past your deadline, so I need to let you folks go and you guys be blessed, okay?
Awesome. Thanks so much.
Bye.
God bless.